This week's sermon is entitled, Love, Not Just Fear. And it's based on today's gospel reading. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The setting of today's passage is Jesus is talking to the disciples at the Last Supper. So Judas has already left. And Jesus, this succeeding chapter, is sharing his teachings again, trying to reinforce them to the disciples. You may have read last week in the chapter where Philip once again is kind of like, what's up, Jesus? And Jesus sets him straight. There's a sense of urgency, isn't there now? I mean, Jesus knows for that which he is going. And I sense this sense of urgency in his words to his disciples. I'd like to focus today specifically on John 14:15, verse 15 from our reading. Let me read it to you again. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. There's three words that stand out to me: love, keep, and commandments. And I'd like to start with commandments first. What are Jesus' commandments? Must be important, right? It's right here. In the context of the Gospel of John, right before this passage, in John 13:34-35, Jesus says, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. And right after today's reading, it says, Jesus says in John 15:12, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. In Matthew 22 and Mark 12, when a scribe, a lawyer, asked Jesus, teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest? Remember what Jesus responds? Love God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus says in Matthew 22 that on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. And in Mark, Jesus kind of actually melds them together by saying there is no commandment greater than these. So these are some of the paramount commandments of Jesus. But what doesn't he say in verse 15? Jesus doesn't say, if you fear me, you will keep my commandments. He doesn't say, if you don't want to be punished, you will keep my commandments. Now elsewhere in the gospel traditions, the gospel narratives, Jesus talks about fear, right? Like Matthew 25, I'm often worried I'm the goat, not the sheep. When at the end, we're going to be judged, the goats and the sheep. Remember Jesus says that wonderful line about, or passages about, because you fed me, clothed me, etc., you will be with me. And the folks are going, we didn't feed you. We didn't clothe you. And Jesus goes, remember? What's he say? That's not rhetorical. What did he say?
If you've done
this,
the least of these, you've done it for me.
You've done it to the least of mine, these, you've done it for me. So there's a little bit of fear for those of us who may not have had a good day with our wife, our neighbors, right? I'm sure you all never had that problem. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Jesus says to folks, it's better to have a huge millstone tied around your neck and be thrown into the sea than it is to cause children to sin. I probably struck fear in some people's hearts, right? And then in John 8, it's one of my favorite examples, particularly now that God willing will be ordained someday. Because Jesus is talking to the religious leaders. Remember in John 8, it's a woman who was caught in adultery. The religious leaders bring the woman there, and they're like, oh, she was caught in adultery. You know, we need to stone her. And remember, Jesus right in the dust and just kind of says, let them who's without sin throw the first stone. And then it's really interesting. He writes again. Remember, the religious leaders took off the grass, right? Have you ever wondered why they took off? What's scary? One author I read imagined that Jesus was writing their sins in the dust, and so that people could see them. The religious leaders tend not to want you to know our sins. So Jesus surely wasn't remiss with fear. But that's not what he's saying here. Generally, what Jesus is saying, I think, throughout the Gospels, we are to fear the results of our sins. Sins that usually involve not following his two commandments, not loving God, not loving our neighbors as ourselves. Things that we see in the Gospels, like oppressing the poor, oppressing women, oppressing foreigners, oppressing children. Jesus didn't and doesn't want the faithful to be fearing the one true God, like folks did the petty gods of Greek and Roman mythology. Gods hurt and interfere with the lives of humans, often on whims. Yet for too long, many Christians, many denominations, have focused only on the fear of God. I'm preaching only a gospel of fear. God's going to get you if you are blank. Fill it in yourself. God's going to get you if you're Italian Catholic, Irish Catholic, Jew, black, white, yellow, red, green, a religious leader, civil authority. Fear and even hate that drives so many of the children of God, young and old, away from God and the church. People like our dear friend Floyd, my wife and mine's dear friend Floyd. Floyd was an amazing guy. We met him at the wonderful Presbyterian church that Hope and I joined after we got married 28 years ago. I had to put on my ring so I wouldn't forget. I can't get my ring off anymore, though. He was a quiet pipe smoker who said profound things and funny things, often in a deceptively soft voice. He had one of those real soft voices. He was the guy in the committee that would speak last, and then it was done. He also had a wicked sense of humor. His blue eyes would just sparkle when he was telling a joke. And they would sparkle when he got mad. And in that same soft voice, he would just continue even in anger. He helped us with the Habitat Project that Hope and I initiated at that first church. But beneath that exterior, Floyd had been deeply scarred as a boy. He had been deeply scarred by the churches in which he was raised. This beautiful, loving man was taught to fear God so much that there was no joy left in his faith, and little joy left in him. Only fear and, quite frankly, self-loathing for being such a sin-filled boy and young man. Boy told us that without faith and without church for a long time, he felt lost. Yet that irresistible grace of God still called to God, his own self, Paul Floyd, God's own self. Floyd started participating in the living rooms, and then the cafeteria, and then the sanctuary of that church. On committees, became elder. He discovered in our Presbyterian notion of God an entirely new way to be in relationship with God and the folks around him in church. Floyd discovered, in responding to the grace and love of God in ways big and small, he felt his life lighten up with the glow of the living, loving God. And in turn, you know what happens when that happens, right? He lit up the lives of others. So what does Jesus say? If you love me, you will keep my commandments. This one statement is so profound. Jesus, God, wants us to simply and profoundly love God's own self, love him. He wants us to rejoice in the loving God, wants us to stay in communion with God's own self. Like a good mother or father, as your example this morning, Pastor Ed, God loves his relationship with us. We are made for this relationship. God created for us and created us for it. Like it says in our Westminster Shorter Catechism, man's chief end is to glorify God. That's the one we always remember, right? But the second part of that sentence is, and to enjoy him forever. To be in joy with God forever. That's the kind of news that was revelatory to Floyd. God, joy, what is this? What's this about? Calvin wrote that true piety consists in a sincere feeling which loves God as Father as much as it fears and reverences as Lord, embraces his righteousness, embraces, and dreads offending him worse than death. Not of death, but of offending God like we dread offending the parents that we love. It shatters the fire and brimstone notion of God that many of us were raised with, right? It demolishes the law-hating God that many of our fellow churches project to the world. And that needs to be shattered, as our friend Floyd would tell you, as I'm sure some people in this room would tell you. God created us to love and enjoy God. God created us to love one another just as deeply and profoundly and joyfully as God loves us. This notion, this conviction of a loving God, not fearing God, so much that we want to keep, that's that third word, keep Jesus' commandments. And this is an interesting word. Some of the translations translate it as obey. The Greek word, and I'm going to be clear, I was a word geek before I went to seminary, because you know, I imagine somebody saying, oh gosh, this guy just got a seminary, he's got to show off his Greek. No, I was a word geek before that. This word, keep, is probably better translated like the Hebrew garden, to guard, to serve. Calvin talks about embrace. There's that notion of embracing, literally in the Greek, of keeping it close to your heart. So when Jesus says, keep those commandments, sorry about that difficulty. When Jesus says, keep those commandments, literally, having them become a factor of ourselves, our lives. And that changes lives, doesn't it? I know, because I've talked to several of you, and I'm sure there's others here too, that this conviction that God is a loving God, that we are in joy with God, was new when you came to the Presbyterian faith. And I say again, there's Because everything I look at through the lens of evangelism. And I'm not talking about the intrusive evangelism of someone knocking on the door at 10 o'clock at night. I'm talking about the evangelism of literally what it means to share the message, to be in relationship. I try to look at everything we do through that because of the huge number of people that are not only unchurched but unfaith. So when I read gospel, when I read other parts of the Bible, I'm thinking, how does this help share this great notion of a living, loving God? So I think that the knowledge of this is vital. I think that the knowledge of God wanting us to love God, of Jesus Christ literally being, as the gospel says, in us and us in him. Please look, seriously, look to your right and your left right now. Look as if Jesus is, not as if, Jesus is in that person. It changes, doesn't it? How we look at somebody, no matter how much they annoy us, no matter how much they get us angry. I'm sorry, it's always interesting when you can see the fear. Yeah. I know my wife's got a lot of grace, that's for sure. Don't folks outside these walls need to hear this? Don't we want to share with them what we have right here? No brainer. Of course. Because sharing God by demonstration, sharing the good news by demonstration is at least as important as proclamation. One of my favorite church mission statements. And often these days, unfortunately, Christians are known more for what we are against than what we are for. And in this passage, my brothers and sisters, we know what we're for. We're for this living, loving God, to know it's not a burden to live righteously, but a joy. A joy to love God and love our neighbor as ourselves. Our families, our communities, the world is hurting and groaning and longing for this message. So let it be us that shares it every day in every way, big and small.